right. Well, thank you, Dinar, for that welcome. And I'd also like to welcome everyone here today. Just really briefly, I'm going to run through the outline of the contest since this is the first time we've done this. We're hoping this could be something that happens every year because a lot of states do have, this is actually a really huge deal. They have collegiate contests and then there's a national collegiate event that each state can send two competitors to. So we would love if this kind of grew to be a tradition and you could invite, you know, participants from other colleges even to apply to compete and even have maybe some round robin, you know, rounds during, preliminary rounds during the day and then the finals would be in the evening or something like that. So anyway, it's a great contest. It kind of gives something for a lot of you like myself that were in FMA to do as a competitive event kind of once you're out of high school into college and get into real life, and there aren't always all those opportunities. If any of you guys are like me, I still like to compete with them. So anyway, just basic outline of the contest. All competitors are going to give a 30-second opening statement, and then there will be 25 minutes of discussion on the topic. At the end of that, we'll have a minute of quiet time so they can prepare their thoughts and make some notes, and they will each then do a 1-minute closing statement. And then after that, we'll allow them to introduce themselves, and we've got some PowerPoint. I'll talk a little bit more about the Farmer Rancher program and Farm Bureau, as Dinar mentioned. So we'll go ahead and get started right away. I guess the one other thing I'll mention, I think most of you guys figured it out, but it looks like there's a pretty good assortment of food in the back, so feel free to get that whenever you like. So for tonight, our competitors are from left to right, are Andrew Miles, Gabrielle Redhead, Jamie Brentano, and Gregory Christensen, and they will be discussing the topic of how can we influence state and local policy that more effectively balances the social and economic interests of farmers and ranchers versus burdensome federal regulations. I'll now ask the competitors to make their 30-second opening statements in voluntary order.
I think the most important part of influencing state and local policy is for people to get involved. If people aren't involved, there aren't a lot of decisions being floated around, and without a lot of people making these decisions and ideas, the policy on the local and state level will be poor, and that then the national government is forced to make policy, which is burdensome as a blanket over across the nation. I think important ways to get involved are advocacy groups, like in Oregon, we have the Oregon Cattlemen's Association and the Young Farmers and Ranchers and the Oregon Seeds Council. So people who get in all these groups, I think that's really important in helping state and local policy.
The average American is 3 generations removed from the farm, and I think this is one of the problems we have when it comes to federal regulation as well as local and state policymakers, is that they're not as closely tied to the farm. So I think something that needs to be done about this is education, connecting the farmers and the policymakers.
Good evening. So this discussion is really important because this issue is something that is being talked about all around our country, and we're definitely seeing a response from the general public as well about the importance of agriculture. Things are kind of going a little bit differently probably than what our industry would like to see, and that's primarily due to education. So we need to look at how we're educating the general populace, which is also our customer and therefore our voter. They're voting with their paychecks every month for our products that we're providing. And we're gonna need to be educating everybody that's involved in the process as well, all the way up to legislators.
I believe that the biggest part of this issue that we need to address is advocation, like my other competitors have stated, because it is how we encourage and allow voters and people who make these regulations, government officials, to understand what we as farmers do and love every day.
All right, for the participants' opening statements, we now open the floor to discussion.
As we all stated, I think an important part to this subject is
big portion of that would be social media. I mean, I sound like I'm beating a dead horse here, but at the same time, it is the first screen that we see every day, our phones. We have, what, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, everything right at our fingertips. And if we can push and share and like and share photos of our green grasses and why agriculture is so important to us, it'll reach one or two more people who potentially never seen that before and never felt that. And I feel like that's something we need to do, not only creating Facebook pages, but creating a means for people to find those.
I have a bit of a different angle that I think maybe would be effective as well. Definitely social media is something that we're going to need to be looking into because it is very relevant to our population. But really, I think maybe what we need is a form of trickle-down education where we are talking about educating everybody, and it's not just in educating the consumer. It's about educating, like Andrew says, educating the farmers. So maybe the first step is to go in and sit down with some of our farmers, bring in some communications experts. Farmers are great at doing what they do best, and that's farming. They're not great at talking to people. They're not great at being the voice of the industry. If we can sit down, teach them what they need to say, then they take that on to the general public. They're talking about what they know they need, what they see are the problems that they're facing with the general public, and then those two groups go together and talk to the legislators. Legislators aren't going to move a finger for the 2% of the population, but if the other 98% is part of that discussion, then they're definitely going to be willing to kind of change their position on different things. And then those legislators can complete the trickle-down education policy of bringing in new programs and finding funding for ag education programs in our schools. So we need to start with everybody. It can't just be about the people who do have that social media, although that is a great one to implement as well. But if we can focus on all members of the population, not just the 2% that already know it, or that 98% that they might be interested, might not be interested, some of them might have access to things that we're talking about right now, but a lot of them go without any kind of information about agriculture or agriculture policy.
I think it's
what
Farm Bureau does, and that's it's helping farmers improve so that they can send their message and take it to the capital and send the message of what farmers are doing, and especially when it comes to legislation, they have programs in place to help that. So I think that the Farm Bureau was one way of really helping educate both farmers and the general public as well.
Right along with these ideas, I like what
lessons, any subject.
in our children and the upcoming generations. I also feel like we need to start leaning towards the current voters. Who is our customer base? Who is actually going to be implementing this legislation that causes so much trickle-down effect? And I think organizations like Friends of the Family Farmer, which creates a coalition in a local area, allows for people to come together and really understand their area's agriculture. What's going on? What are the issues? What do we need to do? How can we help? And I feel like companies and organizations like that need to expand and need to grow, and they need to have the support from the farmers. And I think another piece of that is educating the farmers on what is out there. Because most of the time, we're outside, we're farming. Like, we don't have as much time to sit down and research on what's out there, what's available. And I think that's something that needs to start being put in the works, is educating the farmers on what's out there to help people.
Yeah, you know, most often we're playing catch up and always trying to solve the problem after whatever happens comes up. And whether that's a Chipotle advertisement that's on TV, or whether that's your neighbor that's coming up and saying, well, I'm going to vote for Measure 2-89 because blah, 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 blah. We have to be there and be talking about it before that becomes a news topic. We have to be there and be part of the general discussion that all of us are talking about. Agriculture is an industry that every single one of us has an interest in, because every day we go home, put something for dinner, and then, you know, we're going to be eating some of these products, the products that are grown here in Oregon, even. And so if we don't take an interest in it, then our legislators aren't going to take an interest in it. But we really have to get the conversation started in Oregon, and I'd be interested to hear any thoughts that you guys have on how we can really push that conversation beforehand, aside from educating our children, which I think we all pretty much stand for, and I think it's a great next step.
One idea I was thinking about when I was looking at this topic earlier, and I'm not sure what the groceries towards cost today would be, but what if farm groups or groups like the Young Farmers and Ranchers went to your local Albertson and just had a stand outside kind of telling about where the foods come from, where the beef and that they're going to go in and buy? I mean, the next might be some kind of amount of steaks for that night, but a lot of people don't realize where those steaks came from or how they got them. So if you had, and it's just an idea, but had farmers or be outside grocery stores, like Walmart, any of them, Safeway, and just be telling people where the products came from that they're going to go in there and buy and eat that night. Because people don't realize where they come from.
Yeah, I think there's definitely a lack of communication between the customer and the source. It's really easy to go down to your local Safeway and pick up whatever you're going to be making.
Something and I've got nothing else to do but watch it fry. I'm going to look at and maybe just having another medium to go through to reach our consumers to say, hey, maybe you want to learn more. Look at this website.
I think there's really two great ways to kind of bring that awareness into the store. I really like the idea of having it be like there for them to read. I think some of it goes a little bit back to what you were saying earlier about just spreading the word. Along with like a local food business, that's becoming so big for consumers that they want to know where their food is from. And you know, it's causing some of these regulations, and that's also causing farmers to have to share their stories so that we know what is going on. And I think that's really great thing. There's farmers out there that are trying to learn, share their story, to blog, and to get the word out there of what's really going on with their farm. That's part of what Oregon Farm Bureau wants to do most.
Yeah, I mean, Oregon Farm Bureau obviously is going to be something that we're going to mention a lot tonight, and they definitely are very important. Luckily, we do have a group that is able to go out and talk with farmers and be kind of that middleman in between and facilitate the conversations that need to be happening. But we're also all students, and everyone that's in this room is a student, and we can do the same thing too. And like going back to the social media concept, that's what our generation does. Like you mentioned, everyone gets up and the first thing they look at in the morning is a tablet or an iPhone or whatever the electronic medium is. And so if we have something in every kind of source like that, then the more exposure we have, the more likely that consumer's going to understand what is so important. So if it's putting something at the front of the store where there's a farmer and he's talking about his product, saying this is how my cattle are raised, and this is why it's humane, and this is why this is what is normal for the industry, and this is why maybe we don't show it to you all the time. Maybe there's a reason for that, and then it's not that we're just trying to hide something that's a valid practice or something that is really failing in our eyes. So I think that's great that everyone seems to be on the same page and wanting the same ideas all around.
So once we get the public educated, and we've kind of touched on different ways to educate the kids, educate farmers, educate consumers and voters right now, how are we going to tie that back to local and state policy? And I think that is finding out what the policy farmers in different areas of the state need, because Oregon agriculture is so diverse that even one blanket policy over Oregon is going to help some farmers and hurt others. So do we need to make these policies at the county level, or I don't know how a section of the state level, what we're looking at here. I mean, other states like Iowa, it is so much, the actors are so similar that yeah, a statewide blanket policy is probably going to help everyone. But in Oregon, I think it needs to be broken down by the county or at least a section of the state. And so how are we going to do that? I think it's important for farmers when they're wanting a policy, they need to go and talk to their legislators. And a lot of them, I feel like, don't think that's going to do any good. A lot of them are kind of fed up with government or politics or whatever. But I think since everyone has an idea, no one goes and sees their legislators. And so their legislators don't know who the farmers are. They don't know what they want. They don't know what they care about. If the farmers would go to their legislators and local ones and say, hey, this is something we really need to make our farm look better, to help our economy, what kind of policy would we get involved here to help with that? I think that would be really important. And then once the legislators start to write that up, hopefully we'll have educated the public so we can get that policy flat passed.
Yeah, unfortunately we're in a serious predicament here in Oregon where we can't do things at the county level. Senate Bill 633 forbids any of the counties or local municipal governments from having any control over agriculture policy. It leaves all of that to the state government. And so, like you said, talking to the legislators, that's going to help because we need to at least let them know that we have a presence in the conversation and that there are things that we need, and there's definitely going to be some common ground where we can agree with what they're already looking into. And unfortunately, though, the other side of that, of doing things at the county level right now,
one thing that needs to be recognized is also a national level, and how the national policies that are put into effect affect state level policies. There have been quite that when passed at the national level have caused states not to be able to actually execute their plans of action on what they wanted to put in place. And I think that's something that does need to be addressed. And of course, that's through the state legislature, and that's through the farmers talking to the state and talking to their county and figuring this all out and just having that overall communication. And I think there's a barrier that definitely needs to be broken down. I think we need to step up and say, you know what, I'm going to go out and talk to this person just because I am so fed up.
Yeah, there used to be a day when we could go and talk to our legislative representatives at the state level, on the federal level, and say, this is what our concerns are, and what are you going to do to solve this, or what are you going to do to solve this? And we can't really do that anymore. We're very distant from it. But if we can come together as a coalition of farmers and concerned citizens and people within the industry that actually have factual data to back up what we're saying, I know a lot of our competition going from the opposite angle, sometimes makes up some of those statistics. The whole 98% of statistics are made up on the spot. That definitely applies often. But if we come in with factual data, and again, with our farmers and with concerned citizens, then they're going to have to listen. But right now, Washington, D.C. is on this side of the country, and Oregon is right over here. And so there's a lot of disconnect between the two. And definitely, like, what our topic for this discussion is about is how we can bridge the gap there and bring that information to Washington, D.C. We need to be talking to the people in Salem and Sacramento and Olympia for sure, but we need to also have some representation back in D.C. So I'm excited to see what we can do as a future generation. Hopefully we'll be able to get more of an open line of communication.
I kind of said it in my opening statement, but I think involvement by farmers is important for everything we talked about with the education and legislators. Like Gregor said, it's hard for an individual to go talk to the legislator and get something done about it, but if you'll join a cooperative or advocacy groups, those groups do a really good job of getting legislators, and legislators listen to them because they know that those people support or are backed by a lot of constituents. That's what all the legislators want. They want constituents to like them so they can get the vote. And I feel like I just had a meeting with some farmers today who are really active. And what they see is they are really active, and there's a couple other farmers that are really active. But when they're tired of being involved, they step down. There's no one else to fill their shoes because other farmers aren't getting involved. I think more people need to get back and get involved in advocacy groups such as the Oregon Seed Council. I was talking to today, he said, I'm the chairman and I'm about to step down, and there's really no one else to take my spot. No one's stepping up to do it. And those kind of groups, like the Oregon Seed Council, they're the ones that the legislators are going to listen to. But if they're not, a bunch of fired up farmers want something done, then it's going to change, and they're not going to listen to that.
Yeah, the individual really can't start that conversation. I mean, the farmers that I've been speaking with are concerned and they're very angry, but they express those concerns to me, and they don't express them to their legislative representatives, and they're not reaching out to local media and saying, this is why there's a problem, this is where this isn't working, this is why we can't have people in D.C. that are making decisions that are affecting Oregonians and Oregon agriculture, and not having any kind of connection between the two so that those people who are making those decisions have no idea what we're doing out here. So I definitely agree that we need to have those big coalitions of people down together as a group. It's difficult to say no to 500 plus people if they're standing outside of your office. One person is pretty easy to kind of look over that. So I definitely agree with that.
I think in a way we've kind of gone back to where we started, and that's where we need to work on educating people. You can think of getting younger people involved so then that they can take on the roles of the people trying to set.
one piece of the circle started, then you'll never get the circle completed. I think the part that, as agriculturists, we need to figure out is what part of the circle to start with to get it done. And that, do we need to go out and just, we need to focus on getting consumers educated right now? Do we need to go to legislators right now? Do we need to get involved and join these groups and take it to the legislator? Where's that part of the circle that we need to start so the whole circle can go through? Because that one part of that circle, it's never going to work because everything keeps coming back to education, keeps coming back to talking to legislators, keeps coming back to farmers needing to get out and educate the public. So you've got to find that spot in the circle to start where we can get that done. And I think it kind of depends on what you want with your local and state level policy. If you want something changed immediately, well, so then you need to educate the public, and then you need to get these big groups to go to legislators. But you've got to have the public educated first, the consumers right now. But if it's something that you're kind of worried about in the future, like 20 years down the road, maybe the kids are this place to start. Kind of start to the ideas with them, get really involved with the local groups, the cooperatives, the advocacy groups, get them kind of on board with what you see happening in the future. And so when that comes, that's 20 years later, you need this policy made. People are educated, you have a big group, your legislators know what's happening, all of a sudden this law gets made and you can pass it.
I think where we need to focus is fires under farmers of this is your livelihood, this is how you make your living, this is how you live, this is what you love. Show everyone. I know when I get passionate about something, I'm just like, let's do this, like I go full throttle, and I think that's something that we really need to show them. You can use that to go out and do the education, to start the circle, to just start the conversation, and I feel like that is something we need to show the farmers how to do. I feel like the coalitions that we've talked about, and just us as students can go out and talk to them and say, hey, this is what you can do. You are capable of this. And putting our own passion and our trust in, you know, saying, good job, you guys can do this.
All right, timing's been called. I would then thank the competitors for their great discussion, and if I could ask the audience to remain quiet for 1 minute so the competitors can prepare their thoughts for their closing statements.
Yeah, so I think something that we discussed a lot today, obviously, was the education aspect, and need to look into how we can educate the consumer in order to get that information onto legislators to make some meaningful change. As I proposed initially, I think we need to start with the farmer, and I think that was something that we brought up several times. We need to teach the farmer how to talk to the general public, and then we need to teach the general public and the farmers how to go and approach a legislative representative. And then once our legislators know what we actually need, then they can enact some new policy, and that policy can be to educate our youth and to bring in that aspect, bringing again full circle all the things that we've talked about today. But we really need to focus on getting those legislators to understand what's happening. After speaking with Ron Wyden a couple of weeks ago, he had no idea what part of the state blueberries were grown in, and I had to kind of educate him a little bit on that. And so they really don't understand everything. We need to cultivate a communication, and we can do that through Common Ground.
I think that today, applicable point for this whole discussion that all of us can do and all farmers can do is get involved. Once we get involved, we're going to get that circle started. You're going to start building the advocacy groups. You're going to build the commissions. And when you get involved, you're going to learn how to educate the public, educate the children. That's something that we pounded home today was the education. And once you get involved, these advocacy groups and commissions are going to start to grow. And as they grow, legislators are going to listen. Size really does matter with these. Like I said, our legislators, Mark Wyden, he doesn't understand where your blueberries are growing in Oregon. I mean, all this many agriculturalists, they know it's kind of automatic where blueberries are grown. Our legislators don't understand. So if we get involved, join these advocacy groups and give them big numbers, they're going to listen. People are going to get educated, and hopefully we can get the votes we needed when we put the policy out there that we want voted on.
So I think we discussed a lot of different ways that we can make a difference at state and local policies so the vote regulation doesn't feel so burdensome. And I think in the end, we've kind of found a key down to education. You know, we've talked about how the farmer needs to know how to tell their story, and a lot of that comes from, as I said at the beginning, being distant from the farm. Not your general, you know, person voting isn't from a farm. They don't understand how that's happening. And so farmers learning how to tell their story, and then in that way, consumers learning, you know, we talk about both old and young, how both of them need to learn. So thinking about both the present and the future, in the end, I think we found it came down to education.
Percent of the populace is at a disconnect from agriculture. They're not directly related to a farm. We need to start reconnecting and bridging the gap between the general population and agriculturalists. The only way we can do this effectively and efficiently is as a team. As the rest of my competitors have talked about, we need education. We need to understand how to educate. But one way we need to do that is we need to come together as a group and start these coalitions. We need to look at local levels, we need to look at the state level, and figure out what's going to work for us. Not everyone's the same. I mean, not all of us raise blueberries, not all of us raise cattle. We need to really come together and effectively and efficiently work towards a better agriculture system in Oregon and in the nation.
All right, again, I would like to thank Andrew, Gabrielle, Jamie, and Gregory for, as Dr. Alexander said, being our guinea pigs for the first ever discussion meeting here on campus. I would now like to dismiss the judges to go with our committee, webinar committee member Mike Hathaway and Austin Miller to tabulate scores.